Hello students, hope you all are doing well. This is ICT for grade 10, first term, first chapter, Information and Communication Technology, page number 1 to 31 in your reading book. This is our roadmap. In this lesson, we are going to learn about data and information, system and information system, the systems we come across in our day-to-day activities, characteristics of quality information, information and communication technology, applications of ICT, and finally we are going to discuss about evolution of the computer. So the very first topic that I have for you here is data and information. Students, what is data? Data is a collection of numbers, words, images, or symbols which do not give a meaningful idea when standing alone. They are raw facts. Look at this example. We have three different words like John, delicious, and cake. Here we have a number and a dollar symbol. These things individually do not give us a meaning. So let's see what is information. Information is processed data and it gives us a meaningful idea. The important thing here is information helps in decision making. So look at this example. Here we have processed our previous data set and got some meaningful ideas like the cake is delicious, it is $5, and John purchased cake. So these things gives us some meaning. Now we are come up with the detailed example. Look at this. Here we got a data set which includes names and marks of students. They are written separately. So you can see that it is very difficult to get a meaningful idea from this data set. Then what we have to do is we need to organize this data in a proper manner. Look at the second table. It shows the organized and summarized data. We can see both data and information in this table. We used student name and subject marks as data. And after that, we have got some information like total, average, and rank. So the teacher will be able to get required information using this table. And also, the teacher can make important decisions using this information. Students, you can refer your textbook for more examples. Our next topic is about system. What do you mean by a system? System is a combination of interrelated components that work together to fulfill a specific task. Here you can see an image of our human body. The human body is a good natural example for a system because it is made up with different interrelated organ systems such as circulatory, respiratory, and nervous system. Not only that, there are many kind of organ systems are there. So these all systems work together to achieve a specific task. What is that? It is functioning our body. So what happens if we separate circulatory system from our body? Will the human body function as usual? No, definitely no. So then we need to understand that a system have to have all the components together in order to achieve a specific task. Now we are going to discuss about information systems. I am pretty sure that you may have heard this term before. What is an information system? It is a kind of system which converts data into information. At the same time, it gives a facility to store our data. All of you know that information systems play a very important role in today's world. These are the components of an information system. Basically, there are three main components called input, process, and output. Submitting data into the system is called input. Processing given data according to the instructions and storing data is called process. The output is giving out the required information. Here, I have a question for you. Is the computer an information system? What is your opinion? Yes, it is a kind of information system because computer takes our inputs, process according to our commands, and gives us the required output or information. So, we can identify the computer as an information system. Now we are moving to some examples for information systems that we come across in our day-to-day life. I hope that you will have seen this. The ATM machine or automatic teller machine. This is a kind of information system because it takes input, processes them according to certain instructions, and gives us the output. Let's imagine that I'm going to withdraw some money using ATM. Tell me, what are the inputs of ATM? Our ATM card and PIN number, amount of withdrawal, and what it does is the system processes our data according to the certain instructions and provide money as the output. This is another example. Processing business information. We learned that information helps in decision making. Here we can see how it happens. A company inputs their data like purchases, sales, income, year, profit, expenses into their information system. And what information system does is it processes given data and give some information as the output. This information can be a monthly report which describes the income comparative to previous year. So this information is helpful for top management to make decisions, because if the monthly income is less than previous year, they can take new decisions or new strategies to increase their income. Our next topic is characteristics of quality information. In order to make a correct decision, the information obtained should be of good quality. Here, we have identified five characteristics of quality information. So, the first one is relevancy. That means, do we really need this information? I'll explain with an example. So imagine that there's a requirement to submit your higher educational qualifications. So in that case, you don't need to submit all the academic information from your preschool, right? So the second one is completeness. How comprehensive is the information? For an example, if I'm going to do a research about per capita income of Sri Lanka, I should collect information from all the group of people who represent different income levels. Otherwise, my information can be incomplete. The third one is accuracy. Is the information correct in every detail? For example, if a doctor gets wrong information about the patient's condition, it could be really harmful to the patient. Fourth one is timeliness. How up to date is information? So information should be always up to date. For an example, today's weather report may not be useful to decide tomorrow's weather. Last one is cost effectiveness. Can we produce information without spending a lot of money? So think about a situation. An organization spends more money than the profits to collect some information in order to increase profits. Is it useful? No. So always information can be easily produced with low cost. Information and communication technology, we call ICT in short term. Exchanging the information among different people or among different systems using technology is called information and communication technology. Man has been processing and exchanging information since ancient times. But today, with the advancement of the technology, it has become an easy task for all of us. Now we are moving to applications of ICT. Today, it is very hard to come across any person or industry that does not get the use of ICT. Here, we are gonna discuss how ICT applies in e-government, education, health, agriculture, transportation, entertainment, business and industries. The first sector is e-government. When a government communicates with its citizens, companies, government and non-government organizations, and with other governments from different countries using ICT, we call it as e-government. Here are some examples for e-government websites available in Sri Lanka. Government Information Center, ICTA, that means Information Communication Technology Agency. So this e-government concept helps to improve the efficiency of the government services. Students, you can go and visit this official web portal of Sri Lankan government through www.gov.lk. So then you will be able to see what are the different kind of e-government services available in Sri Lanka. So here we have divided e-government services into four different categories. First one is G2C, that means e-government services that government provide to their citizens. As an example, payment of utility bills. The second one is G2G, that means e-government services within two different governments. As an example, Sri Lanka tourism information. The third category is G2B, that means e-government services between government and business. As an example, business registration. The last category is G2E, that means e-government services between government and employees. For an example, forms, gazettes, circulars, etc. Now we are going to discuss how ICT applies in education sector. Let's look at some of them. There are many ways the computer and the internet are used for education in the classroom. There are some examples for that. First one is for presentations. Inside the classroom, we can use presentations for learning purpose. Videos on experiments, creations of images and video, desktop publishing of magazines and letters, gathering educational information on the internet, educational games, learning using CD-ROM. The other thing is education anywhere, anytime. If you have a computer with good internet connection, you will be able to study while at home or any other convenient place for you. For this, you can use following educational websites to do self-study and improve your knowledge. So you can use schoolnet.lk, nanasana.lk, etaksalava.lk. These are very common websites. And this concept helps to minimize the difficulties of traveling, and it also saves the time and money. Next thing is, in education sector, ICT help for the teacher as a teaching aid. For an example, teachers can use pictures, animations, audio visuals to explain subject areas that are difficult to explain. And teachers can use ICT for making interesting lessons using electronic presentations to obtain information relevant to the subjects and to organize lessons using the computer. Learning management system is another ICT application in education sector. It helps to manage school system and higher education system. We need an internet connection to link with the LMS. Here I have mentioned very common LMS applications such as Moodle, Blackboard and Google Classroom. These are the facilities that learning management system provide for a student as well as for the school government. We look first what are the facilities that a student gets from the learning management system. The first one is the students will be able to use the learning units at any time and anywhere at school, at home or any other convenient place. Second one, the student has the ability to upload the assignments completed at the home. Third one, the ability to submit queries, getting replies and submitting comments through forums. Fourth one, the students able to participate in the co-curricular activities via video. The last one is parents can monitor the progress of the children from the home. Now we look at what are the facilities that school management is getting. First one, the ability to add quality learning materials, supervision of activities and publishing of results. The school management is able to maintain updated information of students, teachers and school, submitting questions, getting replies and providing comments through forums. And also finally, they will be able to send and receive necessary information by email to parents, school development committees and any other school officials. So learning management system is very useful for any kind of education institute. ICT available higher education for everyone. With the development of ICT, today a person from any country can connect with a university or any other learning center and obtain the higher education at considerably low cost. This is called online distance learning. So these are some advantages of online distance learning. They are flexible time frame. You can adjust your time frame according to your convenience. Digital library facility on joining a course. Online assignments and quizzes. Contact with a teacher online. Easy to obtain teacher consultations. No need to waste your money and time. You can easily meet your teacher virtually. The next sector is health sector. ICT used in health sector for diagnosis. There are numerous high-tech machines which helps us in the diagnosis and treatment of diseases. Diseases can be diagnosed at the early stages and the patient can be given treatment accordingly. There are some examples for such machines. The MRI machine, which provide us a very detailed report, and CAT machine, it provides three-dimensional images, ECG, blood pressure measuring machine, and there are many other equipments that uses ICT. Next topic is telemedicine. Under the health sector, we can discuss this. So nowadays, doctors use ICT to examine and provide health care to a patient who is far away from the hospital. This is called telemedicine. Doctors are able to remotely connect with the patient and provide necessary consultation. Here I have mentioned some areas of telemedicine. First one is home health medicine. So that means keeping the patient at home and monitoring his or her condition using a home monitoring system. The second one is telemedicine consultation. That means providing necessary consultation at the emergency treatment unit when the patient is not physically available in the hospital. Third one is telesurgery. Students, you can refer your textbook for more examples. The next sector is agriculture sector. Today, ICT has created a new revolution in the field of agriculture. This is such an example. ICT for farming. Automatic machines are available today to ease the work of the farmer who worked hard in the field. These machines not only ease the work of a farmer but also enables him to produce high quality products. Here I have mentioned some machines used for agriculture in developed as well as developing countries. The first device is meteorological devices. These devices are helpful in assessing the weather, climate changes, and wind directions. Such data are useful in deciding on the crop cultivation and harvesting times. The second device is automated insect control devices. Using this device, we can minimize the harmful effects caused by the insect. Last one is we can use robotic machines to crop harvesting process. This is another way that ICT applies in agriculture sector. ICT for farmhouse and fishing industry. The first example is radio frequency identification device. In short term, we call it as RFID. Using this RFID, we can identify and count the number of animals in a large area. Second example is farm management applications. Today, farmer uses various kind of computer applications to keep track of information on his farm, calculate profit and losses, to save employee salary details, etc. Not only that, the farmer can monitor market rates, get updated on latest business information and exchange information as well. The next main sector is business and industries. ICT is used in manufacturing high quality products and reduce the cost of production by minimizing the use of human labor in many industries and businesses. Today, many industries are using robotic technology because it is very faster than human hands. Video conferencing is very popular among business communities who are geographically separated. They don't need a special place to have their meeting. It saves time, effort, and cost of traveling. Online shopping is another very famous. Online shopping is another very famous service which uses ICT. Companies can sell their products or services at the same time. Consumers can buy goods or services via internet. There are some advantages of online shopping. We can select any global commercial organization which is on the internet. It operates 24 hours. We have the ability to see the things and order at one's convenient place. We are able to pay using the electronic payment methods. Next section is transport. Transport sector use ICT to minimize the traffic jams and to detect people or vehicles who violates the traffic laws. ICT in entertainment. Various IT devices and equipment have been invented to provide some peace of mind to human beings who are spending a very busy life today. We can listen to music to overcome our monotonous life. We are able to watch missed TV programs or movies. We can exchange information between friends and relatives who live in abroad. We can watch high quality video. The children can do learning activities and play games during the free time at home. We can read e-books on the internet. Our next topic is demerits of ICT. If you use ICT in an undue manner, it may cause undesirable effects to you as well as to the entire society. The following are some of them. First one is addiction. This can happen to student or any other person who use the internet or computer without a limit. They may lose their track of education and end up with very bad side effects such as headache and back pain. Next one is building unsuitable friendships through the social media. Third one is cyber attacks. When the computer is infected by a virus due to improper use of the internet, it may not function properly. Mental disorders due to visiting improper websites. Obesity due to less exercise. Isolation, violating copyrights. Publishing of disordered photographs and videos of individuals affecting their personal lives. Evolution of the computer. From the time when the computers became automated, they were categorized into various generations as below. First generation. Time duration is 1940 to 1956. Vacuum tubes and punch cards were major hardware technology. First generation computers generate high heat, slow in processing, large in size, not portable, very expensive. It consumes lots of electricity. Second generation, time frame 1956 to 1963. The major hardware technology was transistors, tape, floppy disk used for the storage. Second generation computers, smaller in size and expensive, low power consumption and low heat generation, comparatively faster than the first generation computers. Third generation computers, 1964-1975. Major hardware technology was integrated circuits. High capacity disk used as secondary storage. Keyboard and mouse used as data input devices. Third generation computers smaller in size and expensive. They also generate low heat, low power consumption, comparatively faster than the second generation computers. Fourth generation computers, time duration 1975 to 1989. Major hardware technology was microprocessor. Large scale integrated circuits and very large scale integrated circuits. Large scale integrated circuits and very large scale integrated circuits also used. They are very small in size and portable as well as upgradable. Fifth generation. Time duration 1989 to present. Ultra large scale integration is using as major hardware technology. Very high capacity hard disk and optical disk and also internet is using. Fifth generation computers are less expensive, very smaller in size, easy to operate and portable, high reliability and efficiency, as well as they use artificial intelligence. Okay children, that's all about today's lesson. These are the things that we have learned so far in this chapter. You can use this summary to make your own short notes. Here I have given some questions and I hope that you will write down the answers in your writing book. At the same time, you can refer the textbook for further knowledge. Thank you all of you, and I'll be back with the new session soon. Till then, you take care. Have a nice day.